Lawyers of Reddit, what is the most outrageous case someone has asked you to take? Had a case where a man refused to pay rent because his apartment smelled terrible and was making him sick. His landlord tried to evict him. A few days after taking the case and before his first hearing, the ceiling in his bathroom collapsed. Turns out some plumbing wasn't connected and his ceiling/walls had been filling with poop for weeks/months. The landlord settled pretty quickly after that. Holy FCK, that's disgusting. You should hear the cases they teach in most property classes. One really famous one of the person trying to sue the landlord for having no hot water. Turns out the water heater flame was put out when the basement was entirely flooded with sewage. A woman called saying that she had a product liability suit involving animal crackers she gave to her daughter. I was thinking it was going to be something to do with food poisoning and keep listening. She explained that when she looked at the crackers, it looked like the monkey was holding its penis, it was a banana. This woman was mortified and ashamed. She said she told all her co-workers and they were very shocked and uncomfortable. I wanted to tell her she was nuts and that they were probably freaked out because you were talking about animal cracker dicks. I got a call from a client I had represented in the past, wanting me to help out her son. He and his girlfriend wanted to get married, but she was under 18, so she needed permission from her parents, and they wouldn't give permission. We chatted about it for a while and then she told me it was an urgent matter, because the girl was pregnant. I said, "Wait, how old did you say she was?" Mom said 14. I said, "And how old is your son?" Mom said 20. I said, "You need to immediately hire a criminal defense lawyer to help you with this." And then I had to explain to her why her son had a bigger problem than not being able to get married. Edit: this was in the southern US. In this situation, there was an extremely high chance that the son could be charged with statutory rape and child molestation. I didn't look up the laws, so I don't know if her being pregnant would have allowed them to get married without consent. Even if they did get married, he could still be charged. They never called me back, so I don't know for sure what happened, but I knew the family and I don't think I ever saw the son's name pop up on any court dockets, so I guess it all worked out in the end and nobody made a fuss about him knocking up a 14-year-old. Skeptical. I remember a guy called me and wanted to take action against the post office. He had received a letter from them saying that they would no longer deliver packages to him as he was never appropriately dressed when he opened the door to accept them. I remember being nervous about asking him to elaborate. My family member sued me for taking down their website. I created the website. I hosted the website. I had no problem doing it since they were family and it ran on my server. Unfortunately, they got too much traffic. They started being very hostile to my parents. I took down their site. I sent them a letter about how families should treat one another with a passworded zip of all their files. The password was at the bottom of the letter, so they had to read it to receive it. Got sued for six figures. They were pulling in at most $300 a month. They said that I did irreputable damage to their site and that they couldn't get the site online because it was impossible. In court, they brought the whole database printed out. When they showed it to me on the stand, I laughed because I told the judge, that's all the information that they said they couldn't receive or open. All the counts were in my favor. Best part was, prior to our court session, my lawyer suggested highly that we settle out of court. I offered $10,000. They didn't take it. After they lost, their lawyer asked if we could just settle on the amount from settlement. My lawyer told them to fuck off. It was glorious. As a public defender, I defended a grown man accused of stealing magic cards from Walmart. There was an hour-long security video meticulously showing, from dozens of angles, that he was picking up sets of cards, unwrapping them and discarding the wrappers around the store. He insisted that he was innocent and we actually went to a jury trial instead of securing a plea deal. It took the jury 8 minutes to convict him and the judge laid into my client, telling him that he was the worst thief he had ever seen. I forgot the best part. At one point in the trial, I had to spend 45 minutes explaining to the judge what magic cards are. He couldn't understand why anyone need more than one deck. First case out of law school, three-way custody battle between a dad who was in and out of jail on drug charges, mom who was an escort, and grandfather who had a library of child pornography on his phone, our client. Mom was also paying her lawyer by trading services. Mom ended up winning custody, on the condition she stopped being an escort. Late to the party, but I have two, both I will admit are friends rather than myself. The first case is the case of the donkey fucker. A friend had to try and defend a bloke who got caught three times being intimate with a donkey on the local farm. The guy kept on getting caught because he had to take a stepladder with him, and every time it happened the farmer spotted the ladder bouncing up and down behind the fence every time the guy walked to the barn. The barrister in this case had defended the IRA in the past and his words were bloody long step away from the IRA but the same amount of money. The defendant didn't have a case and was completely open about his bestiality in open court, no shame whatsoever supposedly. The second is actually a friend of mine who is a magistrate, basically volunteers from the community who act as judges in smaller cases prior to Crown Court. I am unsure whether you have these in the rest of the world. A guy appeared before magistrates, where I think he had attacked a police officer. They first watched a video of the event with the guy shouting all sorts of obscenities at the police. He then, when asked to answer for his crime, started to pretend to speak another language. His solicitor just said, "Please forgive my client, he does speak English, however he is an idiot." After this blatant lie of trying to speak a foreign language, which was complete and utter nonsense, he then started to pretend that he was deaf and dumb, thus started to mimic what he thought was sign language, pointing at his mouth and shaking his head. His solicitor again, "Please forgive my client, he is not deaf and dumb, he is just stupid." My friend who was heading up the magistrate's board, then said to the defendant, "Please take a seat, Mr. X." He responds, "Yeah, no problem, love. Have far more than these if interested." Many years ago, when I was still a trainee solicitor, my then mentor wanted me to see a client on his behalf. He didn't give me any details other than he was a new client and I was to take initial instructions. Criminal law BTW. So there I am, keen but wet behind the ears, when this very large man comes into my small office and starts to inquire about the legal age of consent, 16 in my country. He then tells me the reason is he wants to start producing porn and wants to be sure about the law. Well, then that changes the answer, as it is a different question, 18 in my country. He gets upset and animated, saying how he wanted to produce porn that had much younger girls in it, 14-ish. I explain the legal implications of this and how he would find himself in jail in very little time. He then goes on to his next idea, which is he wants to produce porn for animals, not bestiality or anything like that, videos of two animals making love, and he wants to retail it to domestic pets. At this point my mentor had overheard some if not all of the consultation. Without saying a word he walks into my office, up to my desk. I kept a picture of my family dog on my desk, he takes the picture of my dog off my desk and leaves the room. It was the strangest consultation I have ever had to this day. The day after President Obama won the election in 2008, I had a potential client cold call for a claim of copyright infringement. He wanted to sue then-President-elect Obama for having 7 US flags on the podium during his acceptance speech. I asked him for a registration number so I could verify details and he hung up on me. Edit, second most outrageous case was a potential client wanted to protect, copyright, maybe patent, a Wii sex game that used the Wii controller and Wii Fit. I wanted to take it, but was voted down by the firm. When I told the inventor this, he said, in a resigned voice, "Third time that's happened." I really felt bad for that inventor but put him onto another of my friends who was a solo IP lawyer. Edit 2. Some people are confused about the 7 flags thing, and upon review I can understand. The potential client claimed he had copyrighted the use of 7 flags on a stage for presentations. This is ridiculous and would never have been allowed a registration. But he didn't know that. Likely the potential client was high, drunk, or a scammer. My guess is he wanted to file a lawsuit, then sit down in a boardroom during pre-trial motions and try to settle for a nominal sum. He would get a few thousand, minus lawyer fees, and go away. Unfortunately, the potential client didn't understand: 1. You need a copyright registration before you file a lawsuit. 2. You would never get a registration for having 7 flags in a backdrop of a stage. 3. That he was going to get nothing from then-President-elect Obama because he would have had a firecracker team of lawyers at his avail. And 4. Homie, don't play that. It would have been unethical for me to file that lawsuit, as I didn't think it had a chance in hell of succeeding. In other words, I thought it was frivolous and didn't want to test local Rule 11 jurisprudence, i.e., receive sanctions, or lose my license. When I asked for his reg number, that was a clue I knew what I was doing, and he bailed. I worked legal aid for a while. Every day was outrageous and goes something like this: but I have a restraining order on my first ever client. The very first person I ever spoke to in a legal capacity was a woman who wanted to sue her contractor for $250,000 for an unfinished job and emotional distress. First, being upset at an incomplete job isn't emotional distress. Second, the contract was only for about $100,000, and upon further questioning I learned that this contractor had actually completed all terms of the contract. This woman eventually admitted she was suing him because he was rude and always late. I informed her that we would not take this case. Additionally, I warned her that a failure to pay the contract would most likely result in the contractor suing her. She found this idea ludicrous and began to yell at me in my office, first person on my first day, about how she had a right as an American that I act as her lawyer. So I handled that: we are not helping her in this case. 2 days later, I get a call from the contractor's attorney stating that this woman has cited me as her attorney and threatened a hailstorm of suits upon the contractor from me. It took all of 5 minutes for the other attorney to realize what was going on. Heck, they even made sure to remind me of the steps I should take to protect myself from any related suits this lady might bring upon me. Actually, I still talk to this attorney, so silver lining on the first day, I suppose. About a month or two passes, foggy on time frame. Woman comes in again, furious because the contractor sued her and was able to get a lien on the property. She said this was my fault because I didn't help her. I managed to talk her down. She then immediately gets fired up again because they are trying to scam her into giving them all her documents. Turns out, trial on the matter was coming up in about a week, and they had requested photographs of allegedly unfinished work, damages, etc., as well as the original contract and payment receipts. Basically, all stuff very, very typical and reasonable to request and that she is obligated to provide. She, and nearly every client I worked with in this capacity, thought that evidence was supposed to be a surprise at trial and that sharing this information would hurt her case. No shit, it would hurt her case because she is a liar. Anyways, again, not her lawyer. Actually make her sign a paper signifying she understands this. She leaves. Months pass, I'm no longer at legal aid. Lady finds me at my school. I get a call from the fucking dean asking me to swing by. Says he just met with a disgruntled client of mine who says I cost her her home, marriage, and children. Apparently things went downhill fast. She claimed she would do everything in her power to make sure I never did anything again. Anyways, Dean is a nice guy and helped me with my restraining order paperwork. TL Doctor, first client ever was some crazy lady lying psycho who kept thinking I'm her lawyer. She loses everything, stalks and threatens me, gets restraining order filed against her. Either that or the time somebody wanted me to sue their ex's infant for lost sleep. I actually laughed because I thought they were joking. They weren't. Family law attorney here. I just had a custody case go back to court over eyeglasses. My client didn't like the glasses her ex bought the kid. So stupid. I want to go back to criminal defense. Gang homicide cases had nicer people to deal with than family law. I recall that the lawyer whom I first did work experience under described family law as the single most miserable godforsaken profession that has ever existed upon this earth. I was recently in court for an adoption hearing. I am adopting my stepdaughter, so we needed the hearing to establish the identity of the father and then terminate his parental rights. The hearing went great, The father didn't show but called the court in advance to let them know he wasn't contesting, and the judge ruled in our favor. The craziest part was when the judge was basically pleading with us to hold the final adoption hearing because they have very few happy moments in their courtroom and most people just do everything by mail. I wasn't planning on it, but we may actually have the hearing just for the court staff's benefit. When I was a trainee solicitor, my principal had a guy come in who spoke almost exclusively in quotes from US presidents. This was a specialist law firm in a very English town, and the dude was about as English as it's possible to be, tweed suit with leather elbow patches English. He wasn't initially anything to do with me, but half an hour into the initial meeting my principal wandered into my office totally exasperated, which I'd never seen before, and she said, paraphrasing here, "Pro_eggs, you're a patient man, find out what this batshit loon actually wants. It'll be a good first case evaluation for you to handle by yourself." I spent 2 hours listening to him talk. Literally every second sentence began with "as Woodrow Wilson once said," or "as Grover Cleveland once said." He even managed to quote Taft. I mean, even the craziest of crazy doesn't quote Taft. It's Taft for Christ's sake. Anyway, after 2 hours I explained how much the meeting was costing him even though I was just a trainee, and he visibly sagged and said, all blurted out like a naughty child, "I poured bleach on the roots of my neighbor's tree and it fell into my greenhouse. Can you make him pay for the repairs?" I gently explained why that wouldn't work, and he cried, so I called the loveliest secretary in the firm who made him a cup of tea and sat with him until he went home. Lawyer in a small town here. I mostly do estate planning, probate, old people stuff, etc. I have a client that sued his ex-wife for not selling the house after the divorce as she was supposed to. Judge held her in contempt, and asked what he wanted my client to do, and he had her thrown in jail. They are both nearly 80 years old. The client also has something valuable buried on his property for his grandchildren after he dies. I have a sealed letter in my desk that he pays me a goodly sum each month to hold and give to his grandson when the old man dies. What ended up happening to the property? Is the grandson going to have to sneak in, treasure map in hand, and do some midnight digging? The property we threw the wife off of is still in the process of being sold. The man still hasn't died, so who knows what will happen then. He owns 40 plus acres out in the middle of nowhere, so I imagine whatever is buried there. Had a fellow call my office and tell me he wanted our firm to handle negotiations with some of the big companies in the vinyl siding industry. I figured he had some new product that he wanted to sell or license, but no. When he came in, he disclosed that he had discovered a defect in the vinyl siding and actually wanted us to demand a large sum of money from these companies or else he was going to disclose this defect to the news. Turns out he was a day laborer who had just recently been assigned to a construction project and discovered that you can cut vinyl house siding with a sharp knife, which is the way it is actually cut on site to be installed. The siding is supposed to be installed over a plywood backing, but his boss had told him to skip putting up the backing panels to save money. He felt that homeowners were in danger because, without the wood backing, criminals could use this knowledge to enter people's houses, and he felt it was his solemn duty to report this to the public. That is, unless the vinyl siding companies were to cough up a bunch of cash. Basically, his employer was scamming customers and he felt that justified his extortion of the manufacturers and wanted us to legitimize his efforts to extort money from this industry. It was a little uncomfortable to point out that, in fact, he and his boss were the criminals, and that he really didn't have a case. My parents are both attorneys. Most recently, their batshit crazy neighbor asked my dad to serve as his attorney in a slip and fall suit against my parents. He had come over unannounced and uninvited at 6 a.m. on a snowy morning and fell down our driveway. My dad was the one who helped him up and called the ambulance on his behalf. The next day, crazy neighbor dropped off legal documents in my parents' mailbox for my dad to look over to see if he had a case against my dad. And this is why I hate people. I would have exerted all my lawyer skills to find some miserable loophole or precedent allowing me to take the case. And I would press my client to sue for attorney's fees. Seriously, that's a golden dinner party story. Your great-grandkids will come over to see you just to hear that one. Law librarian in a big law school, years ago, pre-internet everywhere. A man used to call the ref desk all the time with odd questions about currency and laws related to it. He claims he is an author and is writing a book about how aliens are going to come to Earth and take over by manipulating our currency system. He has all kinds of questions about counterfeiting money. Shows up in person one day and looks like something out of Central Casting, odd-fitting green suit, gray hair that is wild and looks like it has not been combed since Nixon was in power, glasses, and an agitated demeanor. I spent an entire afternoon explaining why there is no information on how to counterfeit money, why I cannot get a hold of someone in the RCMP to work with him on the subject, and no, you cannot sue the Government of Canada, the RCMP, the Bank of Canada and anyone else who regulates Canadian currency for the secrets to good counterfeit money. The law library is often the first stop for those on their way to determining whether they have a legal action, and think so no matter they find out. The uninformed, the unhappy, those with an axe to grind, a partner to screw over, we often hear it first. Like the girl who wanted to know if there was a bigamy section in the Stray Animals Act, yup, her dog apparently was caught in a compromising situation. And, as a good reference librarian, we never laugh at the question, we save that for later in the back room. I worked on a custody dispute between a mother and grandmother, where both sides were absolutely outraged by the other's claims. The mother was very upset that she was alleged to have been a stripper. I was a prostitute, but I was never a stripper. The grandmother in return, was furious that she was alleged to have 21 cats in her two-bedroom apartment. We only have 17 cats. How dare she flat out lie and say that we have 21 cats? The child ended up living with the father in a different state. A company wants me to patent their competitor's slogan, arguing it has no trademark registration. When I explained them a slogan is not protectable by patent, that slogans cannot be deposited for trademark registration, and that patents and trademarks are two very distinct forms of monopoly, they asked me apply for a generic intellectual property over the slogan. I then proceeded to explain there is no generic intellectual property, and that although there would be ways to protect that subject matter, not every IP right is acquired through registration. This means, as I explained, the competitor holds protection over the slogan. Moreover, I explained that their request is majorly unlawful. They did not budge. I ended up explaining them about ethics, and being very firm about refusing to honor their request. Our contract is now rescinded. Edit, clarification. When I was working in small claims for the court system, I had a man call me who wanted to sue his ex-girlfriend for the 12 years of cigarettes he had bought for her. Also had someone accuse the courts of taking and keeping as evidence the blue energy tube the aliens had given her for safekeeping. When I was in law school, I clerked with a solo practitioner. Our client wanted to go to trial over a charge of impersonating a police officer. What happened that led up this? One night our client got drunk and ordered a pizza for delivery. Now, I've been there before, it can be frustrating to wait forever for that glorious, delicious pizza, especially in an inebriated state of mind. Well, this guy's genius idea to speed things up for himself was to call the pizza place back and tell them he was a police officer and if they don't hurry it up there would be trouble. However, as it turns out, the guy who answered the phone at the pizza joint was a volunteer firefighter and asked for our client's name because he knew all the police officers in that town. When our client gave him his real name, derp, and inevitably it turned out that he was not, in fact, a police officer, a small investigation led to him being charged. Before trial, our client wanted us to argue he had a First Amendment right to tell people was a cop, he doesn't. He ended up pleading out, but that case stood out in my mind. I represent corporate clients in IP matters now, and the stories are less exciting. I had a private client with a criminal/family court matter. He was charged with sexual harassment for sending dick pics and videos of him masturbating to his ex-wife. The client swore to me, in private, that it was baseless and that his wife was lying. He never sent a dick pic in his life. Discovery ended and my office received an entire file folder filled with my client's dick pics. Of course, my client couldn't just take a picture of his dick, it was full body shots, with his face in frame. Sometimes my client was wearing a baseball cap, sometimes he was wearing sunglasses, but without fail, he was always jacking it. To quote Superbad, it was a dick treasure chest. I had to yell at him, privately, because it was an unbelievably flagrant lie to me. I told him he needed to trust me as his attorney. After this confrontation, he only asked one question, how many people saw my dick? My answer was, it should have been 3 or 4. It was probably closer to 50.